What are we doing here? We're chanting. We're chanting. I did a huge amount of chanting today, in like about 20 minutes, 20 minutes, 20 minutes interspersed. So I was driving. I'd drive somewhere, about 20 minute drive, I'd be chanting. And I used the names, chanted Nandamayama, and then another 20 minutes, Jesus Christ, did that. Another 20 minutes, Rama Maharshi. Another 20 minutes, Padmasambhava. Another 20 minutes, Buddha Longchenpa. That kind of thing. So I was able to chant. I'm able to chant the name of these great spiritual coaches along with this looping soundtrack I have on Facebook Reel. And it's it was fantastic. It was just absolutely great. Just stunning, 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 stunning. I'm able to do it. I'm able to do it well. This is auspicious, I would say. Really, really auspicious. And I'm thinking like, okay, but where's the payoff? You know, where's the payoff? So I'm kind of thinking, man, I'm working so hard at this and diligently. Every day I'm just hammering the practicing. And especially bringing in the great spiritual coaches with this. It's just terrific. So I get home Friday, you know, say, okay, end of the work week, made it through somehow. It's been very difficult. And then I just get this bit of news. I'm looking up the PGA Tour news and it says, Nick Dunlap decided to turn pro, I guess on Thursday. I didn't know that. I don't look at the news, really. I say, oh, wow, that's interesting. Okay. And then it says he will be making his professional debut at next week's AT&T Pebble Beach Elevated Event Extravaganza. I'm like, oh, yeah, oh, wow. that's in the neighborhood, kind of. And then I said, well, he's not going to make the cut. He's not going to make the cut. Well, it's a no-cut event. It's a no-cut event. He's going to be there. He's going to be there. And I'm going to be there, actually. I'm going to be there, Pebble Beach. And I get to see Nick Dunlap making his professional debut. And it's just like, wow. That's like watching Tiger Woods make his professional debut or Phil Mickelson or something. I mean, this is a big deal. This guy is... You know, people are saying he could be a generational talent, and he just turned pro, and he's teeing it up down there. Going to be a lot of rain down there, and wind and everything. But he's going to be playing. Well, he wants the money. He wants the money because he didn't get any money. I mean, when he won last week, was an amateur, didn't get any money. So he said, might as well get in the field and get some money here. It's a big event, $20 million, first prize, 3.5 million or 3.25, a lot of money if you're up at the top of the leaderboard. Holy cow. So I get to see him play golf. That is like, it is professional debut. I get to watch Nick Dunlap. Now that is, to me, that's just like, wow. That's a stunner. I never even considered such a thing. You know, this is wow. So, you know, it's kind of, something happened. I don't know. It's just amazing, really. It's just amazing. I just happened to watch him last week, and I never watched golf. I never watched TV, but I was taking care of somebody who watches television. And so I just to keep them entertained, I, you know, put it on the golf. And so I was in there watching some of it with them, and I was able to see him win as an amateur, which hasn't been done since 1991, 33 years. And so he's a big deal right now. I guarantee you, he's going to have a whole lot of people following him and cheering him on at Pebble Beach. What a place to make your professional debut at Pebble Beach. Holy cow. Amazing. Amazing. So, it's, I don't know what to say. Completely unexpected, but just something that's got me psyched up. It just psyched me up, which is good, because I've been doing all this practicing, and I'm thinking like, you know, my life is just, you know, nothing that's changed. I mean, the future looks completely bleak at this point, utterly bleak. And yet I said, let me just keep doing it, see what happens. You know, that's the only thing I got. And it's supposed to work. It's supposed to work. It's supposed to make your life, you know, a splendid life. It's supposed to be splendid life. Well, you know, I get free tickets to the AT&T, and then Nick Dunlap's going to be there. It's like, God, an elevated feel. I didn't know that. God, all the best golfers in the world, most, are going to be there, including, you know, Scotty Scheffler, Victor Hovland, Patrick Cantlay, Rory McIlroy, you name it. And Jordan Spieth is going to be there. Just all the big names are going to be there, except for the ones on the live tour. But they're not. Anyway, that's another story. They're all going to be there. This is like a major. And then this kid is going to be there, 20-year-old kid. I guarantee you, he's going to have a tremendous attention on him. This is like, it's going to have a unique feel to it. It's going to have a unique feel like on no other golf tournament in history. It's going to have that kind of unique feel to it with him in the field. You know, if he gets up there towards the leaderboard, it's going to be just, you know, really something. Because people are looking for the next great player, and they're thinking that this guy may be it. And we'll see. I don't know. I just sort of doubt it, you know, But could be. He just wins as an amateur, you know. The golf in the desert was a putting contest, basically, and he won the putting contest, and he's a really good putter. But the other courses aren't like that. It's a different story. Pebble Beach is, oof. You know, you got to have a really good short game there, because you miss the greens a lot, and it's a different kind of story there. So I don't know what's going to happen, but that's the interesting thing. I mean, is he more than just a great putter? I mean, can he, you know, scramble and score and do everything he needs to do and contend at this? You know, we're going to find out. We get to find out. You get to find out, because I'll bring you video of this. You know, I'll bring you video of this. Is this guy legit? And if he is legit, this gives a huge boost, you know, to golf in the world, in the PGA Tour, that after all the contention the last several years, a horrible contention with the breakaway live tour. It's just like so negative, such a heavy cloud. It just seems like it's ruined everything. And then here comes this kid out of nowhere, and people are saying, holy, you know, hopefully he doesn't go to live tour. I don't want to think about that. His agent has sent a number of players to that tour, so I said, oh, that would be horrifying if he did that. But hopefully he doesn't, and he could interject a kind of, you know, enthusiasm and something the world kind of needs, something to, get, you know, give people this feeling like, you know, some energy and some bounce in their step. But here comes this kid, you know, and he's doing something great. And something, you know, we need something in this world right now. And, you know, I'm doing the chanting thing, and that's fabulous, but, you know, it's just me and maybe a few others of you. Maybe hopefully you're doing it also, which would be great. And I'm doing it, you know, extremely well. I'm advancing it, you know, really, 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 really well here. So we got that. And it is the chanting thing. I mean, I've tried other stuff, and I just get nowhere, just no traction at all. So this is what I'm doing. This is, I believe, is, you know, extremely helpful for the world. Extremely helpful. And I just happen, my job happens, I drive from place to place. And so I have these driving episodes where I'm able to practice while I'm driving. So when I'm driving, I am practicing out loud, you know, hammering this repetition, you know, Shri, Anandamai, Shri, Anandamai Ma, Shri, Anandamai Ma, Shri, Anandamai Ma, Shri, Anandamai Ma, yes, Jesus Christ, yes. So I'm having that for 20 minutes each, at least 20 minutes like that, sometimes longer. Just totally hammering these chanting practices. So that's my golf. That's what I get to do. Profession, chanter. not a bad thing to be. Yeah, I never. It's pretty amazing just how this has happened. But it's here, and of course it's strengthening, you know, the vocal muscles by doing this, and you know, doing a lot of fast chanting too. Yes, 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 Bhagavan Ramana, Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, yes, 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 Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, Sri Sri Sri, Bhagavan Ramana, yes, 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 and just, you know, so if I do it, I want to do like 20 minutes of that intense 20 minutes. That's doing something. That's doing something. Building up stamina, you know, to be able to do that. It is, you know, it's a work in progress. But it's not like you snap your fingers and you can and do this. You know, it's just there's backlashes. You know, to all this kind of stuff. So that tends to, you know, throw you for a loop, and you just have to keep plodding along like a draft horse. You just keep pulling that wagon, you just keep plodding along. You know, that's all there is to it. This is not really glamorous. I mean, it's just a heavy load, pulling a heavy load, and you just have to just keep doing it. One foot in front of the other, that's about it. And we want it. We want a splendid life. We want a splendid life. It's going to be like summer here in the Bay Area in the next couple of days. It's amazing. It's going to be, you know, mid to upper 70s. It's going to kaboom. And then an atmospheric river is going to come and get all sorts of wind and rain, supposedly. Apparently. These meteorologists, you know, they say, well, there's a lot going on out there in the Pacific Ocean. First they say, atmospheric river set to drench the Bay Area, you know, mudslides, blah, blah, flooding, you know, all this stuff. And they say, but there's a lot going on out there in the Pacific Ocean, and, you know, we can't quite be sure what's going to happen. And there's a lot of different, we have a 10% chance of a big, you know, big event, and, you know, this, but you will know more as things go along. And in this case, it's what? That's all that they ever do. They just dither around, and they do these big headlines, splashy, huge headlines, and then they come up in the back of that, they kind of say, well, you know, it's kind of hard to figure this stuff out. Well, it's the computer age, come on. We've run like, you know, 10,000 simulations of this thing, and I'm still not sure what it's going to do. Oh, my goodness. So we really don't know. Supposedly, apparently, you know, it's supposed to be a fairly substantial storm, but that's going to just be right after this super warm-up, a sudden super warm-up. That is very, very, very strange. They say they can break all-time records, the heat just suddenly, poof. Interesting, huh? Very interesting how we're having, like, events that happen quicker, you know, just like suddenly, you know, go from this to poof, to this. It's very different. It's the exponential age we're living in, the exponential age that we're living in. Stuff is just going to happen fast and furious. You know, fast and furious is the exponential age, and you don't know what's going to happen. But we want really great stuff to happen here. So the chanting is designed for a splendid life to arise. That's why I'm doing it. I'm not doing it to have a lousy life. You know, that's no. I'm doing this. I feel this is my best opportunity to have a splendid life. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing it. But you don't see, you know, directly anything change at all when you're doing this. I don't feel anything's different or nothing, no. Still don't feel good, all sorts of stuff. But, it does. I have noticed that breakthroughs happen, tremendous breakthroughs happen, and my life seems to be rearranging itself in very fortuitous ways, like this Nick Dunlap thing. That's a very fortuitous thing. That I came across him in the first place, I don't even, I don't watch, like I said, I don't watch anything on television. Don't even, never turn the television set on. Don't even have one in my room, nothing, no. But I happened to hear his name, like this amateur, and I said, you know what? I might want to watch this guy, see what happens, and I did. So now I shared that victory with him. You know, people are watching that. Most everyone else is watching the football games. I wasn't. Don't watch anything like that. Happened to see him, you know, gut it out and win. That was really very, very memorable to see that. Now get to see him in person. This. So that's, you know, that's kind of a little bit of splendidness. And so I'm trying to do everything possible, you know, to have a splendid life. And you should be doing the same thing. Why not? Why shortchange yourself? We actually are spirit. We're perfection. We have absolute glorious splendor in reality continuously. So we better get used to a truly splendid life that helps us. This world is just kind of like a preamble to searching, a search rehearsal. You can't search for what doesn't exist, really, but you can rehearse the potential to search. And so really all this is we're rehearsing the potential to search for a non-existent flaw in perfection. These lies and everything, it's just a potential rehearsal for a potential search. That's all it is. A rehearsal for a potential search. That's all it is. A rehearsal for a potential search, which is never going to happen. It's never going to happen. So it's maybe it's advantage. I gotta tell you the truth. It's advantage if your life looks completely bleak going forward. Just absolutely ruinous. You know, just the worst possible scenario for me, it looks like. Because then I got nothing to lose. I got nothing to lose. I might as well do this chanting. Whereas if your life looks pretty good, and you got a lot of investments, you got retirement money, you got, you know, a second home, you got whatever, you got this stuff lined up, and you're thinking, my life's going to be pretty darn, my health's good, you know. You're not going to do this chanting. You know, this chanting, what I'm doing is it's being done out of sheer desperation, which is probably a good thing. Like I said, otherwise I wouldn't be doing it. No, I mean, I gut it out every day just saying, you know what, it's do or die. I mean, I got to, this is the only hope I got. The only hope I got, so I got to go all in on it. That's what's enabling me to push all this forward. I feel like I got to do it. It's the only hope I have. Without this, I feel my life utterly hopeless. Forever, it seems like. I just can't seem to make it, you know. It's like you can't swim across the river, you know. You just don't feel like you can do it. There's just a torrent, you know, coming in the world, just a torrent. I don't want to get into it too much. It is not a pretty picture for anyone necessarily. I mean, just like someone just told me today, he said to get a new battery, you know, cost him $400. I mean, it got installed, you know, the dealership, they installed the battery, cost $400. It's like, you know, guys, all guys, when I've told them that, they're just like horrified by this. They're horrified by it. That because guys got to do that stuff, you know. You got to buy a new battery and put it in, you know, get it installed, keep the cars going. This guy's job to keep the cars going, pretty much. So, you know, that resonates with guys. When we heard this, all the guys go, yeah, are you kidding me? That's horrible. You're like freaking out because you got to replace the stupid batteries about every 3 years. You know, there's a chunk of change, and everything's like that right now. Everything's like just like insanely overpriced. And you're just thinking, like, just a simple battery? You're like, I'm going to have to, you know, pay $400 just for a car battery? You know, just, you know, what? This is, you know, this just absolutely is jarring. It was just jarring to us. That's insane. That is just insane. And them only lasting 3 years and all this kind of stuff. You know, what the heck is going on here? The new age, the batteries last 3 years. Batteries used to last 5 or 6 years or more. Used to be a long time in between replacing batteries. And now they're only going 3 years. That is just horrifying. And, you know, it's just... I told a guy that, and he says, I'm going to get an old pickup truck that doesn't have any of that electronics in it at all, just old stuff, and just to be safe on the safe side. This stuff that's going on with cars is scary, you know. People won't be able to afford to have cars pretty soon. There's a lot of people. Or maintain them, you got to maintain them, you know. It's just, And then there's so much stuff going on here that people tell me is going on about, you know, the California and the stealing that's going on is just unbelievable. Oh yeah. Someone said that they had some digging hammers in their garage, and this woman backed her car up their driveway, got out, went into the garage, picked up the digging hammers, put them in her trunk, and drove off. It's all on tape. Police can't do anything. They had a fake license plate. This is a residential home. So a woman did this. You don't expect. You think, oh, it's the maid is coming. And nobody would expect her. You know, just, oh, yeah, I'm backing in. And just matter of fact, she just went there and picked them up and walked off with them. Those things cost over $1,000 a piece. So, you know, it's just the world is topsy-turvy, you might say. It's just letting us down big time, or doing exactly what we wanted to do, which is providing us with all sorts of terrible stuff so we can prove to perfection that we're capable of fixing really, really bad stuff. In hopes that then the perfection will then feel safe in revealing its flaw to us, so we can then fix it. See, we've told ourselves that, well, perfection has a flaw, it's just hiding it from us. So we got to either, if we can't find it because it's so good at hiding it, we can at least convince it to reveal the flaw to us. We say we're here to fix it, you know, but first we got to prove our mettle, you know, and have the gravitas to say, you know, we're really, really, really great at fixing really, really, really bad stuff. Well, in order to prove that to the prime creator, to perfection, we have to then simulate all this really, really bad stuff and, you know, bad, horrible times, and somehow struggle through them. Somehow humanity struggles through it and finally find some kind of fix. And so we can say, you see, even the worst of times, we're able to, you know, finally come up with some solution to it, you know, that kind of thing. But in the meantime, here we are torturing ourselves continuously in order to deal with this. So nobody else has ever said this in the history of this world. Nobody has ever mentioned this, ever. This is how I see it. That's why all this stuff, suffering is going on, all this troubles and stuff, it's all intentional, completely intentional, completely intentional. Jesus certainly set the stage. He did some heavy lifting for sure. He says that everything that we're experiencing is our own choice, 100%. We're absolutely choosing it. Everyone. Nothing ever happens against our will. But then people say, why in the heck would we choose, you know, do this? Well, now here's the answer for it. Is, again, we feel we must prove to perfection that we're able to deal with extraordinarily terrible, horrible, difficult situations. A flaw in perfection must be unbelievably bad, right? And that we're able to find some sort of solution for it. So the only way to prove that is to simulate all these problems for ourselves, terrible tragedies, horrible things, you know, that are going on. And they say, yeah, but I somehow was able to keep going, and I didn't choke, I didn't, you know, give up, I didn't quit, you know, this kind of thing. So we're just torturing ourselves, essentially, on purpose. Nobody's doing it to us. We're torturing ourselves in order to prove a point to perfection that, you know, you can count on us to fix your flaw, so why don't you reveal it to us? So this is a unique perspective on this universe that has never before been given out in this world, and yet it's being given out now. That's pretty cool. Very, very, very nice. That's how I see it, you know. We don't have to just sit there and like, oh, I don't know what's going on in this world, because I know exactly what's going on in this world. I know exactly what's going on in this world. It's exactly what's going on here. We chose to believe that reality has a flaw, and then we wanted to fix that flaw, because then we feel that this would enable us to be experience being prior to perfection without this feeling of intolerable feeling of separation arising. We have a different experience of that. That's what we're hoping to do. But the problem is we can't find the flaw. So we organize a vast search for the flaw, which we call the universe. It's a vast, but it's really a rehearsal for a search, because you can't really search for what doesn't exist. So it seems like we're searching, but it's really, really a rehearsal. There's no real searching going on. We're rehearsing. And it's all potential for a potential search. Rehearsing for a potential search, making a potential search real. And in that search, we have to, since we can't find it, we've been trying to find it for so long, wow, we decided, you know, let's really put the screws to ourselves. Let's really torture ourselves. Let's put ourselves through really horrible stuff to prove to the to perfection that we were capable. You know, it can trust us. We're professional sufferers. So basically, we cooked up this hell, threw ourselves down in this hell, or at least these locational devices we call body minds. So we can just suffer really, 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 really bad, and choose to suffer really, really bad. It's a choice, believing that might work. We hope it works. But how do you find what doesn't exist? How can perfection reveal what doesn't exist at all? The flaw that doesn't exist. It can't. It cannot. So all this is really just a rehearsal of a potential search. Is just nothing. Much ado about nothing at all. Much ado about nothing at all. Yep. And so this is a different way of looking at the situation. It's a better way of looking at it. It's a vastly better. I can't tolerate the old ways of looking at it anymore after seeing this. You know, this answers so many questions that have not been answered before. You know, wow. But again, Jesus really provided some major keys here. He just said, you know, you, each one of us, it's impossible for anything to happen to us against our will, any experience we can have. It's impossible to have any experiencing at all that isn't our will to experience it. Impossible, Jesus says. So throw out karma right there. You know, just throw it out. Okay. Throw out determinism. Throw out all this stuff. You know, that says, well, you got no choice but to suffer and stuff. Jesus says, that's not true. You cannot have any experiencing whatsoever that's against your will, because you're perfectly free. You are perfectly free. So if you're perfectly free, you must be choosing to experience what you're experiencing. There's no way around that whatsoever. No way around that whatsoever. If you're experiencing something against your will, then you're not free. You're not perfectly free at all. Jesus says we are absolutely perfectly free. That is the nature of reality, the great perfection. We are absolutely free. Therefore, we must be choosing to experience what we're choosing. No way around this whatsoever. No way around. Light of pure reason shows you there's no way around this. There's no wiggle room whatsoever on this one. So, this is looking at that way, then why are we choosing to suffer? Oh. So this is the new insight that has come. Because again, we're trying to impress perfection. So perfection looking at us like, wow, you know, they're like, you know, the world's like totally screwed up, you know, and they're just like suffering so bad and just this horrible, you know, situation, and yet they're standing up to it. They're struggling through it, you know. They're finding ways. They're innovating. They're not quitting. And we think of our perfectionists looking at this and saying, wow, you know what? I can really trust Spirit to fix that flaw that I have. So let me reveal that flaw to Spirit so it can be fixed. That's what's going on. That's what's going on. Can I get a hallelujah for being able to express this here in the world, which has not been expressed before. Expressing theories like this, which has never been expressed before, is quite something. It's quite something. But like it's a, you know, it's do or die, and I just like I got no choice. I gotta keep pushing ahead with this whole scenario here. So here it is. Fortunate. And there you go. Yes. Practicing my golf clap. Yeah. Golf clap. Rolls on the birdie putt. Well done. Or rather, yes. You can practice yes to a golf clap. Yes. Now on the tee from the University of Alabama, Mr. Nick Dunlap. Hey, Mr. Like that. Oh boy. I may even get some cigar. They're passing out free cigars. I don't know if I even smoke a cigar. I have no idea. I should smoke a cigar there. Or at least chop down on one. Why not? It might as well enjoy the ambience of the situation. Oh my goodness. So, stuff's coming up. I mean, we're going to be having a time this weekend. Very nice. I'll maybe tape out in beautiful coastal California. Possible. That's a possibility. I don't know. But probably. It's a probability, you might say. Maybe it's a probability. But I never know. I don't try to script stuff in terms of what I'm going to do or what's going to happen. I just let the Holy Spirit. I'm just going to channel, let the Holy Spirit take care of all that kind of stuff. It'll be better if I do it that way. If I do it that way, extraordinary stuff will happen. Whereas if I try to make it happen through my own ingenuity, it doesn't work as well at all. It really doesn't. Serendipity has to arise. Synchronicity, serendipity, you know, those things are what really is important. And so just go keep, you know, stay chanting here. Buddha, Buddha long, see, Buddha long champa, Buddha long champa, Buddha long champa, Buddha long champa, yes, 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 do the yes, 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 Buddha long champa, Buddha long champa, Buddha long champa, yes, 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 sir. Padma Sambhava, yes, Padma Sambhava, Padma Sambhava, Padma Sambhava, Padma Sambhava, yes, 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 to the yes, 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 to the yes, yes, yes. And those are the chanting. And I enjoy doing it, you know, again, without any idea of what the effects might be. Yeah, that's what's kind of nerve-wracking. I have no idea what the effects are going to be. But, you know, it's just what else is there to do? You know, I mean, if you look at the world, just what are we going to do? Just nothing? You know, just stuff that's happening in this world is horrific. It's horrific. And just the inflation and the crime. You know, the insecurity, the edge to things, the uncertainty to stuff. It just doesn't feel, you know, like this is a splendid situation, really. And so, turn it over to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit knows how to disperse this universe. It'll disperse it exactly equally everywhere. That dispersal, we can experience that right now. It's already done that, actually. It's already finished the entire thing, and we can experience right here and now this absolutely equal dispersal of everything that's ever arisen in this rehearsal for a potential search. Completely equal, absolutely smooth. Holy Spirit's already done that, so we can experience that. Why not? Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, yes, 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 to the yes, 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 to the yes, 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 Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, Guru Padma Sambhava, yes, 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 to the yes, 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 yes. Maybe Guru Padma Sambhava will show up at Pebble Beach. He's already shown up once. He did a visitation. Broke the ice on visitation, and it's not surprising he would do such a thing. He's willing to do that kind of stuff. Yeah. So maybe they'll all show up at Pebble Beach. You know, really, so I invited them all. You know, come on, I'll host the party. Let's go. And you know, there was no celebrities this year. They cut the celebrities out of the weekend. I'm like, what? No Bill Murray and all the celebs. They have no. Just Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and then they cut them out. And the ones Thursday, Friday are not from the entertainment industry. It's just sports like Buster Posey and Steve Young and Tom Brady and, you know, guys like that. I mean, nice to watch Buster Posey play golf. Oh, heck yeah. I would have enjoyed doing that. Buster's a big deal here. And Tom Brady, of course, a local guy, is a big deal. So that would be a heck of a lot of fun to see those guys, but we're not going to see them. We're going to just, you know, see the pros. But now we got that kid. So that's like, yeah. That is a person of interest right now. Holy cow. That's going to be something. Hopefully he gets up on the leaderboard. I just, you know, it's like, in, you know, leading or close to the top, you know, this kind of thing, and people are going to be like, wow, you know, let's see what happens here. But the greens at Pebble Beach, here's the problem. They're Poana greens. They grow during the day. They get bumpy. It's so difficult to putt Poana greens. You have to have a lot of experience doing that. It's not like those carpets down in La Quinta. Oh, those things are just like totally true carpets, just pool tables essentially. Just get online, hit it, and it's gonna go in. You know, it's just like, that's not the case with Poana greens at all. There's a knack to putting them, which I don't really know exactly what it is. I can't stand Poana greens. If the tee ball's going in the last second, it goes, you know, like that, or so. You gotta put pace on the ball. And hit it firmly. You know, this is my, can't diet in the hole at all. So we'll see if he can adapt. The key is you got to put pace in the ball, then you have to make the four footers coming back. If you miss, that's the key to it. And he could do that. If he putts with some pace, you know, just your nerves, and he's got good nerves. So, you know, potentially he could handle those greens. Yeah. Remember watching Tiger Woods warm up on the Pebble Beach, on the practice green at Pebble Beach. Huge crowd around him. That was really quite an experience. It was an awesome experience watching him do Tiger Woods do that at Pebble Beach on a beautiful day. That's good memories. So we'll see what happens. But gotta stay psyched up, don't we? We gotta stay psyched up right now. Gotta stay, so whatever we can do to stay psyched up and chant, you know, stay psyched up and chant, you know. Oh, if your life's kind of desperate, you're feeling, you know, like, I don't know, you know, the things don't look so great, chant. I don't believe it's going to hurt you, although last time I chanted for an hour straight, I got sick. But I believe I was sick before I started doing that. You know, I'd caught something a couple days before. It must have been a cold. And so after I chanted the next day, you know, I was whew, oh, got a cold. Shit. It you know, it's been, I don't know how long. It's been a couple of weeks now or something. Yeah. It's been a couple of weeks. And, I'm still not, you know, over it. My sinuses are all blocked up. My ears are blocked up. Sinus, you know, congestion. You know, I can't do anything about it. Really, it's just like can't hardly hear. Hopefully, that'll get better. It's not like it's prevented me from getting sick. But keep in mind, okay, keep in mind that one of the fundamentals of what we're doing is to get sick. Is to have troubles, so we can prove to perfection that we can be counted, you know, to not freak out about some sickness and find a way to get well from it. So that when we see that the flaw of perfection gets revealed to us, we won't freak out. So we're getting sick on purpose. Everybody's getting sick on purpose. Everything that you experience is done on purpose. Period. There is not a single exception to that, which will get you disinvited to about every social gathering in this universe, which is what I've experienced. You try to tell truth to anybody anywhere, they're not going to like it at all. But this is the truth as I see it. Absolutely, it is. Nothing ever is an experience against your will. Impossible. Which knocks the guilt right out of from underneath radical feminine female supremacism, actually, which is built on guilt, male guilt, okay, that they forced all these experiences on women and all this kind of stuff. It just knocks it right, you know, gone, period. There's never, ever been any experience that wasn't 100% our choice, our will to experience it. It should be our choice, our will. Not our bodies, ourselves, our choice, our will. Meaning, whatever you're experiencing, you chose it. It's your, and you willed to experience that. It was your will to experience it. Nobody is guilty of forcing any experience upon anybody else. Impossible. According to Jesus, and I happen to believe Jesus on this one for sure. I believe one on everything as best as I can. You know, some of the stuff is beyond my pay grade, it seems. That's okay. You know, we have to catch up eventually. So, you know, we're under this spell of female supremacism right now, under the spell based on a completely false foundation that the radical feminists have built up over the last 100 years. Totally false foundation, 100% bogus foundation. And our whole culture is based on this false foundation, which makes it very difficult to realize truth. You know, when you've got such a false foundation like this, that's horrible. And I tried to stop it. I spoke up. I said, this is wrong. This is flat out lies. You know, total built on build your house on lies. That doesn't turn out well. Does not turn out well at all. So it's better to say, you know what? Everything I experience is my choice, my will, 100%. Always been that way. It's always been that way. Always will be that way. I have perfect freedom. Everybody has perfect freedom. There's nobody that doesn't have perfect freedom. That includes dog animals. Includes animals. You see, there's another sticking point with people. There's women and animals are the sticking points. And kids. Women, children, and animals. Those are the sacred cows. They, oh no, if something happens bad to them, it's not their will or choice at all. Not at all. Only with guys. Totally false. Even animals, everything they experience is their choice, their will. Yep. Everything that happens is a choosing from spirit, is a choosing from spirit. It's will, it's choosing to experience this. So guilt is gone with the wind.
Yeah, that's true.
You can hardly have a splendid life when if it's being controlled by guilt, that's for sure. That is for sure. Yeah, so those three sacred cows, women, children, and animals. They say, oh, the poor dog, someone's hurting the dog, okay. That, you know, that person's a horrible, guilty person, you know, that kind of thing. No, the dog, too, has perfect will. There's nothing that doesn't have perfect will. How could there be anything that doesn't have perfect will? Then perfection wouldn't be perfect, would it? If perfection's perfect, that means there's only freedom, period. There's no such thing as non-freedom. So the dog is free also. The dog is also free. Everything is free. It has its own free will to choose to experience what it wants to experience. Yeah. You know, humans aren't the only strategy, you know, right? We're kind of late to the party. There's been all this strategizing going on for billions of years of ways to, you know, innovate and survive, you know, survive tough conditions, right? Surviving under tough conditions is how spirit wants to prove to perfection that it's capable of fixing perfection. So that perfection finally reveals the supposed flaw it has, except it doesn't have it. But when you insist that somebody's hiding something, then you can always say, well, I can't find it. You're just hiding it. You know, it's impossible, you know, to force someone to believe that there isn't any flaw. They can always say, no, there's a flaw. It's just it's being concealed. You know, that's why it's so difficult. This is so difficult. How do you prove, you know, there isn't a flaw? When you can say, well, sure, I can't see it, and it doesn't seem to be any, but it's just being really, 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 really well concealed. That's the essence of paranoia. You know, it's like, sure, it's being concealed. It's not. There isn't any flaw. How can there be a flaw in perfection? There can't be. And if you trace it back to how it started, you realize we just didn't like the experiencing of being prior to perfection, this idea. We didn't like the effect of this idea. But that's the only effect there can be, is the intolerable feeling of separation. But we didn't like it. We said that we had to drop the idea. What we didn't like is we had to drop the idea immediately. We said, oh no, we have freedom. We want to play with this idea more. Well, we are free to play with it as much as we want. But every time we choose it, we're going to drop it again. We can do that forever if we want to, you know. Choose the idea, drop it. Choose the idea, drop it. Choose the idea, drop it. Sure, we're still free. There's no lack of freedom there. But we said, no, we want to have a different effect so we can play with the idea more fully. Well, that was our mistake. That was our choice. It doesn't mean that there's a flaw in perfection. Where is the flaw in perfection? This doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. So we kind of need to trace it back and see that it doesn't exist at all. It has never existed. That's the effect of that idea. That's perfection at work right there. We can't be prior to perfection. So we try to experience it, but all we can get is this intolerable feeling of separation. You know, that's this feeling. But and then we have to drop the idea because it's intolerable. Okay, that's it. But we ended up saying, no, I want to experience it more fully. So I have to believe there's a flaw. There's a way to fix this. Must be a flaw then. Because as soon as we said the way to fix this, that means that perfection didn't give us perfection. You see, it must be imperfect, must be an imperfection there, must be a flaw. Then we said, okay, but hey, we can fix that flaw. Let's find out how to fix that flaw. Whoopee! That'll be really fun. Well, hasn't been that much fun. It's been a long, strange trip indeed. I wouldn't call it exactly fun. Torturing ourselves isn't exactly fun. No, it isn't. But it's impossible for us to look askance entirely at our experiencing. It's not possible. You know, we can't 100% condemn our experiencing, even though this has been brutal. We still are going to have some love of our creativity. You know, here it's impossible. How could we possibly completely dismiss our experiencing as all bad? You know, we can't. We can't really. It's not possible. But it's very awful, this experiencing. Very, 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 very awful. It's just we're all soldiering up here really well, pretending like, you know, it's we can soldier on here. It's all a soldiering on sort of thing. Everybody's just soldiering on. But nobody, if you're really honest, nobody's gonna say, oh gee, I just really truly love this. heck no. You get these quilters who might say, oh yeah, life's great, I love doing this quilting and all this nice artwork, and you know, can sit at home and got great retirement, or you know, a spouse that's making a lot of money, enough money, and kids and things. Oh yeah, I love this life. It's really wonderful. It's not really, it's not being honest at all. It's still totally horrible. Totally horrible. I mean, we're just completely vulnerable every instant. Body's completely vulnerable every instant. Yeah, I get this stupid cold, and then it just goes in and is blocking my ears. I got severe, you know, earaches and stuff, and it's like there's nothing you really do about it. You take this medicine, it makes it worse in a couple of days. Yeah, it may make it better for a couple of days, then it'll get worse. Another stuff. Well, it's got these bad side effects. You know, it's like forget it. You know, forget it. It's miserable. You never know. You never know what the next sickness is going to be. You know, oh yeah, I'm really having enjoying my life. Suddenly got hammered by the flu. You know, and you lose your strength and your immune system goes down. And wow, what happened here? You know, kind of thing. So, if you're honest, you'll say this place is just absolutely horrible. There's no other way to put it. Completely ghastly, horrible hell. But we can't hate it entirely. We can't dismiss it that way entirely. So we need to praise our experiencing. Praise our experiencing, whatever it is. Because it is our experiencing. Okay, we chose it. We're choosing it. So this yes, yes, yes is like a praising. We praise our experiencing, and we have a positive, like we're bestowing bestowing the beneficent praise upon all our suffering and misery and all the situation. So I found this to work the best, to have this attitude the best. It doesn't mean that we want to keep choosing this. It means that, you know, we're acknowledging I have chosen this. And since I chose it, and since I am a complete VIP, you know, I can't lose this complete VIP-ness based on what I chose. So I'm reasserting that, yeah, this complete VIP that I am, you know, has chosen to be sick. But the VIP-ness is still totally there, okay? So that's the feeling of praise yourself. Have this praise feeling. Yes, 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 yes. Keep praising yourself in this way. I got to do more of that. That really, really, really works. Really, 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 really works. Great if you can remember to do that. And I'm going to remember to do that more and more and more because that's so important. We're all total VIPs. We're absolutely free. What greater VIP could there be as someone who has absolute freedom? That's what we have. So when you're praising yourself, you're reminding yourself of your absolute freedom. That you are. So you're not like, oh, this thing is causing me to lose my freedom. No, it isn't. So when you say yes, 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 you're praising yourself. You remind yourself of your perfect freedom, even in the midst of the situation. But acknowledging, you know, you chose this, you're choosing this, so you should praise yourself for choosing whatever you choose. You are not any less by what you choose. You're not made any less by it whatsoever. Keep reminding yourself of this. And everybody's the same. So the more you remember this, what you really are, the more you realize what everybody else is too, that they're complete VIPs too. Complete VIPs, yes, 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 complete VIP, yes, 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 just complete VIP, yes, 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 just complete VIP, yes, 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 just complete VIP, yes, yes, yes. How are we doing here? Wow. Whew, just gotta keep chanting. The weekends are pretty tough for me, a lot of responsibilities, holy cow. But you know, one second at a time. You know, 1 second at a time. Actually, it's just if you're chanting in a positive, in a praising yourself way, then somehow serendipity is by your side. You know, it's great to have a sidekick, a serendipity. Have serendipity as your sidekick. You gotta have serendipity as your sidekick now. I call it living a charmed life. You got to have serendipity as your sidekick. And so just imagine that there's serendipity is walking beside you. That's better than a guru. I don't imagine gurus walking beside you. But serendipity is walking beside you. This marvelous capability that serendipity has to bring about serendipitous situations for you. You know, it's walking beside you. It's your friend. It's walking beside you. It doesn't have any personality or deity-ness or, you know, looks a certain way or anything like that. It's just it's a mood. It's that. It's just serendipity itself. The capacity for serendipity just has this capacity for serendipity. So I say, yes, sure, you know, yeah, absolutely, but we're walking together. 100% we're walking together. When you're driving, you should definitely do that. You know, you should do it in every situation. You're certainly driving here. Driving here is just when you think, you know, everything's fine, it's not here. You know, some pedestrians and bicyclists not paying any attention at all. It's just unbelievable. They just, you know, like wearing black clothes. It's late in the evening. They come out of dark shadows and they've got their face on the phone and they're walking across a crosswalk and there's a car blocking you, you know, and it's like, oh, you just seem like, what the heck, you know? They're not paying any attention at all. You know, we say, hey, where's the light? You know, how come you're not looking to see, checking to see, hey, does he see me? Because it's dark, I got dark clothes on, no reflective clothes on. And is that car seeing me and stopping and make eye contact? Hey, I'm here, do you see me? Yeah, I see you. No, they got their face on the phone. It's like, I don't have to worry about that kind of stuff. Well, maybe they got serendipity walking with them, or maybe they don't. Maybe they got a death wish is what's going on. A lot of people have death wishes right now, to say the least. And again, we have said, and this is something that's pretty amazing, but I've said that we intentionally choose all sorts of terrible scenarios for ourselves in order to try to overcome them and prove to perfection that, look, we got the right stuff. So people are intentionally looking to get injured, they're looking to get harmed, looking to get in accidents, all this kind of stuff. Absolutely they are. And I used to be able to see the future extremely well. So I tell people, hey, you know, you're headed for an accident, you're headed for a problem here, you better change your course. And they get like really upset with me, very angry. Now I know why. Now they wanted to get in trouble. 100%. That's their choice. That's their will. This is, yeah. I mean, I had friends, yeah, this good guy's motorcycle accident. Unbelievable how bad he was messed up. He was in a full body cast for like a couple of years or something. It was unbelievable how messed up he got. It's horrible. I visited him once, you know, it's just, but he chose that. And he said, now I'm going to get over this. I'm going to recover from this, you know. That was his big thing. To prove to the to perfection that, look, I can be completely messed up, totally messed up, but I didn't quit. And in fact, I bounced back and I made it. And look at this. So you should trust me, Prime Creator Perfection, because even though your flaw might be really terrible, you know, look, I'm not going to give up on you. You see that? That's exactly what he did. But I always say, how could you be my friend and do that kind of thing? That's just horrible to do to friends, you know? But they're looking at it, they're looking at situation from, you know, from the standpoint of, no, this is my destiny, and this is what I need to do in order to prove, you know, my value to the Prime Creator. But really, you know, friends should be those who don't do that and say, hey, you know, there isn't any flaw, so I don't have to torture myself. So I can live a truly splendid life, truly charmed life, serendipitous life, totally serendipitous life. I don't have to prove a darn thing. That's why people are afraid of the death realm. I've been there, and I started getting a little nervous because I realized, you know, there's not any opportunity to prove yourself here to perfection. Everything's perfect. Nothing's dying. Nothing's injured. Nothing's hurt. It's just, you know, it's just wonderful. But people don't want to go there. They say, well, you know, how can I have troubles there? Can you have troubles there? Can you get sick there? You can't get sick? I don't know about that. They don't want it. They want to get sick. They absolutely do want to get sick, so they can show they don't give up. Things get tough, I don't give up. So you can trust me. You can reveal your flaw to me, you know, because I got the right stuff. I've proven it to you. That's what's going on here. How about that? How many people are going to actually hear this and take it to heart, you know? That's the question. Maybe few, you know. Few at best, perhaps. Few at best, but there's always going to be some. But in terms of most people, there is no, you know, they're just going to say this, get out of here, basically. If you don't get out, then they're going to get more severe measures on towards you, you know, basically, hey, just leave us alone, get out of here, we don't want to hear that stuff, that's it. And they're done with you. That's the truth of the situation here. Oh well, serendipity by my side, splendid life is my ride. Yes, it is. Serendipity by my side, a splendid life is my ride. Yes, 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 yes. And with that, it bears repeating. With serendipity by my side, a splendid life is my ride. Yes, 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 yes,